As we mentioned when we talked about the myocardium of the heart, cardiac muscle is striated in appearance. It contracts using those same sliding filaments that we saw when we studied skeletal muscle. So the actin and myosin, the troponin and the tropomyosin. The cells are short and fat and branched. Most cardiac myocytes have one nucleus, but sometimes you'll find cells with two. Cardiac muscle cells have many mitochondria. They are highly metabolic. Remember, from the time your heart forms until the day you die, these muscle cells are constantly contracting. So they're using a lot of ATP, so you would expect to find a lot of mitochondria to make that high amount of ATP. There are connective tissues and capillaries that fill some of the spaces between the cardiac myocytes. But something that the cardiac muscle has that no other muscle in the human body has are called intercalated discs. So the intercalated discs are made up of some specialized structures called desmosomes and gap junctions. So desmosomes, if you remember back when you studied tissues, form little spot welds between cells. Remember, again, we've got branched muscle cells that are all connected together, and once your heart starts beating, those muscles are continuously contracting. So the muscle cells are constantly shortening those fibers and pulling against each other. So these desmosomes provide some stability of structure and allow those muscle cells to contract throughout your life without the tissue or the muscle cells separating. The desmosomes and gap junctions make up those intercalated discs. So now let's look at the gap junctions. A gap junction is formed where proteins are embedded into the membrane and they create a channel. That channel between the cardiac muscle cells allows for the flow of ions from cell to cell. Remember when you talked about the flow of ions, or when you learned about the flow of ions from outside the cell to inside the cell, depolarizing muscle cell? Well, the same thing has to happen with cardiac muscle cell. Most of the cells of the heart have to have that flow of ions to depolarize those cells. So because those gap junctions extend from cell to neighboring cells, then you have very much a domino effect of depolarization that results in that cardiac muscle depolarizing simultaneously or almost simultaneously, and the heart contracting as a coordinated unit. So we want to talk next about those contracting cells and the cells that don't contract but are necessary for conducting or for getting that electrical activity that causes muscle cell depolarization going. Okay, so there's electrical activity, of course, is the reason for your heartbeat. So the source of that electrical activity is a network of specialized cells that are sort of a mix between cardiac muscle cells and nervous system cells. And we call those cells autorhythmic fibers because they're self-excitable. Autorhythmic fibers repeatedly generate action potentials, and that is going to lead to heart contractions. They continue to stimulate a heartbeat even after the heart's been removed from a body. For example, if it's going to be transplanted into another person and all of its nervous supply has been cut. Obviously, it's outside of the nervous system if it's out of the body, right? So if you've ever seen, there was one of those shows that Andrew Zimmern did on the Food Network where he ate a beating cobra heart. So the chef cut the heart out of the snake, and as he removed it, the heart continued to beat. And that will continue to happen for some time under the right conditions. So these autorhythmic cells stimulate the other cells in the heart to contract. So what is it about these cells? Well, they have to have some very specialized functions, and one is that they act as the pacemaker. So they set the rhythm of heart excitation that then leads to contraction of the heart muscle. They also form what we call the cardiac conduction system, which is a network of these specialized cardiac muscle cell fibers that establishes a path for each cycle of cardiac excitation to pass through the walls of the heart and lead to contraction. So this conduction system ensures that the cardiac chambers become stimulated to contract, as I mentioned a while ago, in a very coordinated manner. so it makes sure that the heart is an effective pump rather than muscle cells contracting in all different places at many different times. So the cardiac conduction system ensures that cells depolarize in certain areas in a certain sequence. So next we'll look at that conduction system. So the cardiac action potentials propagate through the conduction system in this sequence. So if you look at the numbers on this image, you've got a summary in the words on the left, you've got a graphic on the right or an image to show you. So the cardiac excitation begins at the SA, the sinoatrial node, which is located in the upper wall of the right atrium. So it's inferior and lateral to the opening of the superior vena cava. The SA nodes repetitively continue over and over to depolarize, and once they do, they depolarize to threshold. So all the cells in the SA node depolarize to threshold simultaneously and spontaneously. The spontaneous depolarization is what we call the pacemaker potential. So when the pacemaker potential reaches threshold, it triggers an action potential. Each action potential from the SA node propagates through both atria, through gap junctions, in those intercalated discs that we just mentioned. Following the action potential, the muscle cells have depolarized, so the two atria contract at the same time. Step number two. By conducting along those atrial muscle fibers, the action potential reaches the AV, or atrioventricular node, that's located just in the inferior part of the interatrial septum. Interatrial, between the atria. At the AV node, the action potential slows down because there are structural differences in the cells in the AV node. But this provides a really necessary delay that gives time for the atria to contract a little bit and empty the blood into the ventricles. Step number three. From the AV node, the action potential then enters the AV bundle, or the atrioventricular bundle. You may hear this sometimes referred to as the bundle of His. So the bundle is the only site where the action potentials can conduct from the atria down into the ventricles. Step number four. After propagating through the AV bundle, the action potential enters the right and left bundle branches. These bundle branches then extend down through the inner ventricular septum, down toward the apex of the heart. And then the fifth stage, or the fifth step, the Purkinje fibers that begin at the apex of the heart are going to conduct that action potential from the apex of the heart, upward toward the remaining of the ventricular myocardium. Once the ventricular myocardium has been depolarized, the ventricles contract and the blood is pushed upward toward the semilunar valve. So let's trace that here. We have the SA node, which will begin the depolarization. That wave of depolarization spreads through both atria, through those gap junctions, to the AV node, and then the AV bundle, which branches into right and left bundle branches that go down to the apex of the heart, and then smaller Purkinje fibers are going to go out to depolarize the rest of the myocardium, leading to ventricular contraction. So on their own, the autorhythmic fibers in the SA node would initiate an action potential about 100 times a minute. So the SA node sets the rhythm for contraction of the heart. In other words, it's the natural pacemaker. Its rate is faster than any of the other autorhythmic fibers. Because it's faster, it sets the pace for how fast an action potential is spread through the conduction system, and then all of the other fibers then stimulate the other areas, and they're able to generate an action potential of their own at a slower rate. So the SA node acts as the natural pacemaker. Nerve impulses from the autonomic system and certain hormones carried in the blood, such as epinephrine, can modify the timing and the strength of each heartbeat, but they don't establish the rhythm. For example, a person at rest, acetylcholine released by the parasympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system slows the firing of the SA node to about 75 action potentials per minute. Now, remember, our skeletal muscles had to be stimulated by acetylcholine being released from a motor neuron. These autorhythmic cells fire on their own. They are autorhythmic. They self-depolarize. So they are not, under the. Let me rephrase that. They don't have to be stimulated by nervous cells, but they can be affected by things that are released by the nervous cells, such as the acetylcholine slowing down the firing of the SA node, and epinephrine, or what we commonly call adrenaline, causing the heart rate or the firing of the SA node to increase. So the SA node normally sets the rhythm, but if it becomes damaged or diseased, the slower atrioventricular or AV node can decide, okay, I'm going to take over and become the pacemaker. But its spontaneous pacing rate is about 40 to 60 times a minute, unlike the 100 or so from the SA node. So if the activity of both of these nodes is suppressed, the heart can still be maintained by the autorhythmic fibers in the ventricle. So the AV bundle, the bundle branches, Purkinje fibers. But the pacing of these is very slow, 20 to 35 beats a minute, and that causes blood flow to the brain to be inadequate. So the brain is starving for oxygenated blood, starving for glucose. So when this condition occurs, the normal heart rhythm can be restored and maintained by surgically implanting an artificial pacemaker, which sends out small electrical currents to stimulate the heart to contract. So an artificial pacemaker has a battery and an impulse generator, and it's usually implanted just beneath the skin, inferior to the clavicle. So the usual rhythm of heartbeats is established by the SA node, and we call that the normal sinus rhythm. The term arrhythmia refers to an abnormal rhythm as a result of a defect in the cardiac conduction system. So the heartbeat may beat irregular, too quickly, or too slowly. The symptoms, of course, are going to depend on what the cause is and whether your heart is beating too fast or too slow. So chest pain, shortness of breath, dizziness, fainting, lightheadedness. Arrhythmias can be caused by several things that stimulate the heart. It can simply be too much caffeine or stress, or alcohol, cocaine, nicotine, certain drugs that contain caffeine and other stimulants. Arrhythmias can also be caused by congenital defects, coronary artery disease, myocardial infarction, hypertension, defective valves, rheumatic heart disease, hyperthyroidism, or deficiencies in potassium. So we classify arrhythmias based on their speed, their rhythm, and what's causing the problem. So bradycardia is an arrhythmia where the heart rate slows to below 50 beats per minute. Tachycardia refers to a rapid heart rate over 100 beats per minute, and fibrillation refers to rapid, uncontrolled heart rates. So, a heart block is an arrhythmia that occurs when the electrical pathways between the atria and the ventricles are blocked, so some type of damage to the tissues that are a part of that cardiac conduction system, and this slows those nerve impulses from passing from the SA node to the AV node or into the bundle or the bundle branches. So the most common site of blockage, though, is at the AV node. So this is a condition called an AV block. So when you have a block, then the ventricles are not going to receive the impulses as they should, and they're going to start to beat or to depolarize and contract much slower than the atria, and this is one of the causes for the implantation of a pacemaker. Fibrillation, as I mentioned, was where we have those unregulated, so irregular and rapid contractions. Ventricular fibrillation, or VFib, is the most deadly of all of the arrhythmias. So your contractions of the ventricular fibers are completely out of whack. They're not coordinated. They're asynchronous. So the ventricles quiver rather than contracting in a coordinated way. So this results in ventricular pumping stopping, blood ejection ceases, circulatory failure, and death occurs pretty quickly unless there is immediate medical intervention. So ventricular fib, or VFib, causes unconsciousness in seconds, and if left untreated, seizures may occur and irreversible brain damage if the VFib goes on for more than 5 minutes. Death usually soon follows. Treatment involves cardiopulmonary resuscitation, or CPR, and defibrillation. Defibrillation is also called cardioversion, and it's when there's a strong, brief current of electricity passed over the heart with the defib paddles, and this can often stop the VFib and shock the heart back into its normal rhythm. I mentioned CPR, or cardiopulmonary resuscitation. So this refers to an emergency procedure for establishing a normal heart rate and rate of breathing. So standard CPR uses a combination of cardiac compression and artificial ventilation of the lungs with mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. So for many years, this was the only way to do CPR. However, it has become the more preferred method now to use hands-only CPR. The heart lies between the sternum and the vertebral column, two hard structures, so pressure or compression on the chest can be used to force blood out of the heart and back into circulation. So after calling 911, hands-only CPR should be performed. So in this procedure, chest compression should be given hard and fast at the rate of about 100 per minute and about 2 inches deep in adults, and this should be continued until medical professionals arrive. Now, you may be wondering, how do I know what 100 times a minute is? I'm more worried about saving this person's life than counting compressions. So you can use this song to set your CPR rhythm. Okay, so it is estimated that hands-only CPR saves about 20% more lives than the standard or classic method of compressions with mouth-to-mouth. So hands-only boost CPR survival rate. Of course, you do want to be careful when you are delivering CPR to small children and infants or anyone who is suffering from a lack of oxygen, such as people that have almost drowned or in drug overdose or carbon monoxide poisoning. All of these, of course, are going to require a little bit more medical attention and different types of medical attention, but the most important thing is this CPR can serve to keep these patients alive until you can get medical help there. So dial 911, get someone to dial 911, and keep them staying alive. An action potential in a contractile fiber in a ventricle, so a ventricular myocyte, is characterized by rapid depolarization, a plateau phase, and then repolarization. So you can see here the membrane potential changing over a period of time. So very rapid depolarization as that sodium flows in when those gates, those voltage-gated opening, are those voltage-gated sodium channels open. And then there is a plateau or flat phase of maintained depolarization due to the calcium influx when those voltage-gated calcium channels open, and potassium flowing out when some of those potassium channels open, and then a period of sort of rapid repolarization due to the closing of calcium channels and potassium outflow when additional voltage-gated calcium channels open. So the calcium stops flooding in, the potassium starts flooding out, and that leads to repolarization. So the mechanism of contraction is similar in cardiac and skeletal muscle cells. The electrical activity or action potential leads to the mechanical response, contraction. As calcium concentration rises inside a contractile fiber, calcium binds to troponin, which allows actin and myosin filaments to begin the sliding past each other. and that tension starts to develop. Substances that alter the movement of calcium or slow calcium through those calcium channels can influence the strength of cardiac contractions or heart contractions. Epinephrine, for example, increases contraction force by enhancing calcium flow into the cytosol. So more and more calcium coming into the cell leads to more and more muscle contractions. As action potentials propagate through the heart, they generate electrical currents, and we can detect those on the surface of the body using an electrocardiogram, abbreviated either ECG or EKG. EKG is cardiogram from the German word. So either one of these is simply a recording of electrical signals. The ECG is a composite record of action potentials produced by all the different areas that are being depolarized when that heart muscle is depolarizing. So all the different contractions and depolarizations during each heartbeat. In clinical practice, electrodes are going to be placed on the arms and legs, and that's going to be used to record the ECG and give different recordings based on how those different areas of the body or different areas of the heart are depolarizing. Now, in a typical ECG, we have three clearly, easily recognized waves that appear with each heartbeat. The first is called the P wave. Okay, so you see the P wave here. It is a small upward deflection on the ECG that represents atrial depolarization. Remember, atrial depolarization then spreads from the SA node through the contractile fibers in both the atria. Then what happens? The atria contract. The second wave, called the QRS complex, here's QRS. So the QRS complex begins as a downward deflection and then continues as a really tall, upright, sort of triangular-shaped wave that ends with a downward wave. So QRS represents ventricular depolarization as the action potential spreads through the ventricular walls. Okay, so P wave, atrial depolarization, QRS wave, ventricular depolarization. Now notice how much different the QRS is than the P. Okay, remember atria, ventricles. You have a lot more muscle fibers in your ventricular walls than in your atria, right? The atria are smaller chambers and very thin-walled. Ventricles, larger chambers, lots of myocardial cells, right? Thicker walls. So there's more depolarization happening in the ventricles, therefore a larger wave shown on the ECG. The third wave is sort of a dome-shaped wave called the T wave. It indicates ventricular repolarization, and it occurs as the ventricles are starting to relax. So the T wave is smaller than wider than the QRS because because repolarization occurs more slowly than depolarization. Okay? So the T wave, more drawn out and much more slowly, so there's less change quickly. Over here we have a sharp depolarization because the ventricles depolarize very quickly. And then the ventricles repolarize much more slowly, so less electrical change, leading to a lower phase or a lower line on the ECG. In reading an ECG, the size of the waves can provide information as to what's going on with different areas of the heart, so clues to abnormalities. Larger P waves can indicate an enlargement of atria or a single atrium. An enlarged Q wave can indicate a myocardial infarction. An enlarged R might indicate enlarged ventricles. If the T wave is flatter than normal when the heart muscle is receiving sufficient oxygen, then the T wave is going to appear abnormal. It's flatter, and this can be indicative of coronary artery disease. The T wave may be elevated in hyperkalemia. Remember, kalium is potassium, so hyperkalemia, too much potassium. So we can get a lot of information by looking at an ECG. Now, at the end of this, chapter, I'm going to show you some different ECGs and let you see how those look different than what you see in a normal ECG. So let's look at the different steps and the different patterns and what's going on in the heart as we look at what we see on an ECG. So remember, the atria and the ventricles repolarize and then contract at different times because the cardiac conduction system routes those action potentials along a specific pathway. The term systole refers to contraction. The term diastole refers to relaxation. So the ECG wave predicts the timing of atrial and ventricle systole and diastole. So if we're looking at a normal heart rate of about 75 beats per minute, here's what we see on an ECG as related to what's happening in the heart. So step one, the action potential arises at the SA node. It then propagates through the atrial muscle, through both atria and down to the AV node. As the atria contracts, cells have depolarized, the P wave appears on the ECG. After the P wave begins, the atria complete contraction, so atrial systole. Conduction of the action potential slows at the AV node because the fibers there have smaller diameters and fewer gap junctions. So it's very much like when you're merging four lanes of traffic down into two lanes or one lane. You know, you come upon malfunction junction, right? So everybody has to merge. What happens? That slows traffic. Well, that's the same thing that happens with the AV node because those autorhythmic fibers are much smaller. So the third thing that happens is the action potential propagates rapidly again after entering the AV bundle. So depolarization then progresses down the septum, the interventricular septum, and upward from the apex, and that produces that large QRS complex as the ventricles depolarize. So at the same time, atrial repolarization is occurring, but we don't see that on an ECG because the QRS complex, the ventricular depolarization, is much larger, so it gets masked in an ECG. We don't see it. The fourth thing that we see, the contraction of the ventricles, ventricular systole, begins right after the QRS complex begins, or after the QRS complex appears on the ECG. As contraction proceeds from the apex toward the base or upwards from the apex of the heart, blood is squeezed upward toward the semilunar valves. Then repolarization of the ventricle begins at the apex and spreads through the ventricular myocardium. This repolarization produces the T wave in the ECG. Shortly after the T wave begins, step 6 shows that the ventricles start to repolarize, and that is what is known as ventricular diastole.